You know, this field is so exciting to me because you get to leverage all of our capital, intellectual and physical, to transform the environment and make the earth healthy and people healthy. But as we make the earth healthy, we realize that healthy people and poverty kind of don't go together. So the concern that we face is how do we achieve a just transition? Here are some numbers. California right now has the highest child poverty rate, the highest supplemental poverty rate in the nation as well. And there are 2.2 million unemployed or underemployed persons in California right now. So add that to a rapidly contracting fossil fuel economy, and it paints a rather dire picture. So we're hopeful that we can come to some solutions today. And I know at CalCEF, we work hard in this endeavor as well. We have an advanced manufacturing initiative called Supercharge. It's about workforce development around energy storage development. And I look forward to hearing your thoughts as we go forward. So right away, I'm curious as to, just a quick icebreaker, what are some initiatives you're working on?
Are we starting with me?
Sure.
Hi, I'm Assemblymember Autumn Burke. Right now, actually last year we started with Transformative Climate Communities, which gave us about $140 million for community projects, which were local projects in which instead of taking small projects across the state, we actually looked at a more local comprehensive opportunity to one, create jobs like you're talking about, and two, to have actual communities participate. Because what we found in my district, for those of you who don't know my district, I have a really wealthy portion of my district. I have Venice, I have Marina Del Rey, I have El Segundo, but then I have a really challenged portion of my district. I have Inglewood, I have Hawthorne, I have Lawndale, I have Lenox, I have West Athens, which was named one of the 6 most impoverished areas in the state of California not too long ago. And so we thought transformative climate communities gave actual disadvantaged communities the opportunity to see not just transformation, but to truly take part in it. And to also show that businesses, small businesses in our communities could participate in the new environmental economy. So that's one thing we worked on last year, and that $140 million is in the budget this year as well. We are also in the cap and trade kind of initiative conversation, obviously on the assembly side. We lost both bills, but the conversation continues. And for me, workforce is an integral part of whatever cap and trade 2.0 looks like. I don't think that we can have a successful, sustainable program if disadvantaged communities and all communities have just transitions, like you mentioned. In my district, I have a stationary source, I have a refinery, and I have folks on the eastern portion of my district who don't have a college education, but who have jobs that start at $75,000 a year. And making sure that as we move from a dirty economy to a clean economy, it's really important that those folks have the opportunity to have an equal opportunity to move over. As they move to the clean economy, that they are prepared and that our workforce is allowed the opportunity to be educated in the new jobs that are going to be available. And it's really important to my community that they have access to those jobs. So that kind of gives you an idea, but really I think, especially right now, since it's really big in the capital for cap and trade, I think it's imperative that we remember to take into account workforce and to make sure that we fund the programs that allow our workforce to transition properly.
Great. Sure. Oh, great. So thanks for having me here. Well, at this stage, Microsoft is a very large employer in the state, 10,000 or so people. And over the last few years, we've been engaged a lot more aggressively in both internal reflection on our energy and power use, as well as all sustainability issues, which I get to look after at the macro level. But most importantly, there's some new information that we have as a result of the acquisition and partnership that we have with LinkedIn. And so the data, I'm going to look down a little bit, and you'll bear with me, because it's new data for me as well. We just ran a series of reports to gain some insight into what's going on in the big regions in the state, in the Los Angeles area and the San Francisco area. And we see there's an immense opportunity, and then I can talk a little bit about some of the things that we've been doing to support that. So first and foremost, there's about 500 million people who are, most of you probably are, on LinkedIn in some way, shape, or form, about 133 million in the US, and there's 9 million companies and 30,000 higher educational institutions involved and 10 million jobs that are posted that people can see. So within that data framework, we clicked down a little bit and looked into California. And in the city of Los Angeles, looking at the tech economy, there are nearly five and a half million people in the Los Angeles region who are signed up on LinkedIn. So that's the pool that we looked at. And within that context, there's nearly 500,000, 450 plus thousand companies that register within that LinkedIn community, exposing their areas of interest as well. And within that, what we found is that, to your point, Autumn, four out of the five tech workers don't actually work in the tech sector. They work in companies that need technology as part of their business. And about 30% of those people do not have four-year jobs, but they are making significant and meaningful wages. So that's just reinforcing exactly what you said, which we found to be really, really, again, an important opportunity for the community college districts where we're doing a lot of our work at Microsoft and training and things of that ilk. In the San Francisco area, and I'll close in a second, the greatest skills gap in the energy or power generation and management sector really relate to installation and people who can install and maintain. The tech sector per se in the Bay Area is way underemployed, and there's a huge amount of opportunity there as well. And what we found is that the about a quarter of the power generation jobs in that category are available in California in terms of the national interest. So again, the opportunity is huge. And then lastly, I would say that what we found is PG&E, SolarCity, Tesla, and CBRE and SunEdison are those five, six largest entities that are looking for people. So a lot of this gets into skills development. Some of it is sort of hidden in this non quote unquote tech sector, and in general, mapping the training and the skills is the key. So that's a lot of where our effort is going in the technical skill area. Okay.
Great. Thank you for having me here. Commissioner McAllister is so sorry that he couldn't be sitting here. He's stuck on an airplane somewhere, and he would much rather be here. So Andrew McAllister is the lead for energy efficiency at the California Energy Commission, and we've been very busy with SB 350 in two different areas, a barrier study for disadvantaged communities that we completed last year, which has a lot of workforce development and workforce alignment recommendations. It's really critical to bring the disadvantaged communities into the new economy, as we all are here to talk about. For many years, we've had building energy efficiency standards that increasingly have field performance verification requirements, and we've been working with the trades in the state and the apprenticeship programs to make sure that we have workforce that are trained and certified to meet those field performance verification. They're third-party verifications in some areas, so there's definitely new job opportunities there. And with SB 350, we have a challenge to find opportunities to double energy efficiency in the state. And kind of that follows our existing building energy efficiency action plan, which also includes a pretty comprehensive list of workforce development and workforce alignment recommendations, because we know we can't meet those challenging goals without an increased and highly trained workforce. And I'm not going to steal Jim's thunder, because we've been working with him, and I know he's going to talk a lot about that. So I would just say that one of our biggest issues is that we're a state agency, but the enforcement and the quality control of our building standards in large part happen at the local government level. And they are completely underfunded in terms of their ability to implement and enforce some of these really technical and important and critical for the performance of energy systems. We really need to find a way to get them the resources they need to help us not just have paper savings, but have real actual savings in the field.
Thank you. So I represent the California Community College System. My team helps the colleges. We're sort of the business development team for the California Community Colleges. We work with 113 colleges, and that's interesting because it's sort of like herding cats. They all have their local control, and we overlay on top of that. Basically making connections with industry, with the workforce development boards, with funding sources, with the environmental justice community, and so forth, all for the purpose of preparing our students for work everywhere from the generating plant to the wall socket. With similar similar analogy for natural gas and for water, wastewater. So it's a pretty interesting job for a small team. We represent the face of the community colleges to industry, to labor, and I'm very proud of the fact that over the past few years, we've partnered with the major labor unions in the state and with the community, with the workforce development boards, with a number of community-based organizations, and there's actually an alliance that includes all of those entities. There's some 20 organizations represented in the Coalition for Energy Efficiency, and we're very pleased to be a part of that. And our objective is to unify the programs that all of us offer, because they're all separately funded. We all have our different missions, our different stakeholder groups that we're accountable to. And so it makes for sort of a hodgepodge of things out there, and it's not a good use of ratepayer dollars or tax dollars or industry investment. And so we with Martha's help and with Commissioner McAllister's help, we're convening a larger group of probably about 60 stakeholders. These are major industry associations. And individual companies that will help bridge the gap. And the gap looks in workforce looks like this. You know, we need a doubling of energy efficiency. The first mandate, of course, is arriving in 2020 when all new residential construction has to be zero net energy. By 2030, some people interpret the regulation as 50% of commercial floor space needs to be zero net energy. There's 9 billion square feet of floor space in the state. That means we got to work, have to have a workforce capable of converting 4.5 billion square feet in the state to zero net energy. So we're very pleased that this coalition is coming together, that we have the support of the Energy Commission. And the gaps that we're trying to bridge have to do with skills gaps and with the number of workers that are coming into the workforce. There are about 300,000 energy efficiency workers in the state, according to AEEE's most recent jobs report. If you look at heating, ventilation, air conditioning, that's where the gap is most evident, in that about two-thirds of the HVAC workers in the state never completed a program at an accredited college, university, private training institution, apprenticeship program. Two-thirds did not complete an accredited program. And that shows up in the results. And Martha, I may misquote this a little bit, but in the commercial area, more than 50% of the commercial HVAC systems are installed improperly at their initial installation. And the problem is similar for advanced lighting controls, where very, very large gap in number of advanced lighting control programs or systems that operate properly. I could go on and on about that. There's many more examples. A good example of the capacity gap that we have as a state, we looked at facility managers, people who manage the lights and heating and the environment in this building and others like it. And we found in four Southern California counties that there's 24,000 of these facility managers, and the annual demand is 3,200, 3,200 per year. And the annual supply from the community colleges and anybody else, all sources, the supply is less than 100. So it's a very, very large gap. I could quote more data like that, but you get the idea. We've got a big job in making sure that we have a workforce capable of meeting the state's energy efficiency mandates.
Yeah. Well, it's promising that the demand is there right now, despite the gap. Daniel, so what elements of a workforce would Microsoft like to encourage?
Well, the way we think about workforce development, you know, it's like any large company, you look at it through the lens of your customers and your market and where you can at the edge and on the margin make a difference. The lion's share of our business is tied to working with companies, and mostly large companies, but companies of all sizes around the world to what we say digitally transform, to build up a modernized technical infrastructure that leverages big machines and little machines. And what I'd say by big machines are big cloud services, big clusters of machines where they can offset both their operating efficiencies and some of the issues associated with security and privacy and things like that, which are so exposed on a grand scale globally, both at a nation state level, but also at an individual corporate level. So as they lift up their infrastructure need and start to leverage digital technologies, we see two things. Through our own internal investigation of sustainability issues, starting with energy and working on water, we're carbon neutral, have been since 2012. We've got an internal market by which we tax ourselves for spinning up servers and powering our company, as well as people getting on airplanes and all of that ilk. So those monies we use to do our investments and offsets and partnering with grid partners to come up with battery backup from our data centers that feed the grid when the wind's not blowing and things like that. We've done a whole lot of experiments like this, and we're going to continue to do that. So as we learn about those things, we see the large companies that we're working with reaching out to their customers and applying the same kinds of capabilities. So with water management, rather than just selling valves and control systems, the sensors can turn into a water management capability. So we basically follow the customer interest. And so we see lots of interest in people to the point of, you know, installing and managing digitally sensored, energy efficient, you know, systems. So there's a lot of need for systems control, facilities management, hardware installation to install the sensors everywhere and then to manage that. And then the software capabilities or data analytics capabilities that people need. Some of it's coding, so there's a little bit of machine coding, but rest assured these artificial intelligence architectures are going to write code too, just like they're going to displace other jobs, they're going to displace software. So all that stuff's going to happen, but the most important thing is the data analytics. So we see a lot of opportunity in public-private partnerships where you need some level of public data. To the last panel, not all levels of public data, because mission-critical infrastructure really matters. Certain things can't be seen yet and shouldn't be seen as appropriate. So the structural changes about getting the data up and out there require a lot of training and heavy lifting for people to be able to read and analyze that data. So data analytics is really key. So machine, say computational thinking is one way that we think about it. You can look that term up on the web and get a little bit about, you don't have to be a coder, but you need to learn how machines and systems work. So those are the biggest skills, and it's through the community college systems and other systems where apprenticeships, and we see some of our customers working on internships and apprenticeships as well, and then helping design the kind of training materials that will target people to fill these needs and these gaps. And again, back to the LinkedIn thing, they have this lynda.com infrastructure for education and training, but we need to partner to get the content online and work with educators to make sure that that works well.
Excellent.
Okay.
And Martha, so seizing upon the notion of sharing of data for use for applications to help develop a new kind of tech workforce related to the environmental business, is the state forthcoming with this data? Is that prioritized?
Yes, absolutely. So right now the Energy Commission's in the process of updating our data collection rulemaking, which is authority that's been given to us by the legislature many years ago, but we haven't updated those regulations in at least probably over a decade. And we are really excited about the opportunity to, and a big part of Andrew McAllister's vision for this doubling of efficiency is providing data to make informed decisions. So that's not just data coming to the Energy Commission and we put it in a vault somewhere, but we need to challenge ourselves and bring in experts to figure out how and when to push back out that data to all you, all of you, and all of the decision makers, from consumers to businesses, to new, you know, business model development activities, so people can understand where there's potential to save energy. So we are actually partnering with Stanford University this summer, bringing an intern who's got expertise in machine learning in the biomedical field, and he's going to apply that expertise to data science for energy data and help us figure out how much of the kind of statistical information of distributions of energy usage across customer classes, economic, you know, conditions, climate, you know, variability can we provide to the public to help people understand not only how they compare to others, but business opportunities for energy efficiency in the future. We have recent legislation passed last year called AB 802, which authorizes the Energy Commission to create a commercial and multifamily benchmarking and disclosure program. So we'll be publishing large commercial and multifamily energy usage publicly starting in 2019. And we think of that as a way to just kind of make whole building energy usage a public good and something where tenants and building owners can better understand the building performance of the properties that they're interested in buying, selling, leasing, and also help them on their journey to improve the energy performance of those buildings. We're really excited about the data frontier and really from the workforce development area. Absolutely agree with everything you said. Data analytics is going to be, and is now, and will continue to grow in terms of its importance.
Yeah, and I would just pile onto that a little bit, if you don't mind, sort of a little bit of back and forth, and that we run some experiments working with folks at UC Davis on water. I've heard water is going to be important, the insight gained, and it was the academics. We weren't in the system. It was the academics in a locked room, and we were proving out the privacy and security issues about putting things in the cloud. That was our vested interest in participating in this project. But what we learned was, by looking at public data appropriately, and the academics did the work, which was key. It affected the insight into pricing. To again, the last panel, the commentary about, okay, some people are affording themselves large solar arrays on top of their house and they're not paying, and then there are other people who are subsidized for appropriate reasons, mm-hmm. and then there's everyone in the middle. So the pace of regulatory change, which the whole thing about innovation and changing and driving an innovation economy around advanced energy means is we have to change structures, because that's what innovation is about. It's structural change. And you can't make legislative structural changes without apolitical will, but also that's typically gathered due to public opinion. And when, mm-hmm. when the public can see through the use of public data that disenfranchised people are being overly burdened for the mm-hmm. price of mm-hmm. water, mm-hmm. they may be mowing the lawns and not playing golf, for example, but they're paying for the water that grows the grass. And so understanding those things, we can actually see that sooner rather than later with publicly available data. And you take the scientists at Stanford or Davis or other places mm-hmm. to do that, and then motivate the training and then the kind of policy changes that we need. So we're on the verge of a lot of this, and it's happening very, very, very quickly.
That's amazing. And Assemblymember Burke, you have been at the forefront of generating so many policy changes. And I'm curious to hear your thoughts on how you would characterize a just transition and how do we ensure, you know, comparable wages and...
I think it starts actually younger than most people realize. In my district recently, we did a coding kind of seminar where we had 400 of our kids in one of our most disadvantaged communities learning how to code. And what I think most people, and lucky for most people in this room, they don't understand that you don't know what jobs exist if you've never heard of them. You don't know sometimes what is possible if it hasn't been presented to you. So if you don't start when these kids, we did it from first graders to fourth graders, because they don't even know what to imagine sometimes. They can imagine, when we teach them that math leads to Madden, or that math leads to their energy production, then all of a sudden they have some sort of reason to show up to school, to learn coding at the seminars and to take part in them. And I think that a lot of times that gets lost, is that we take advantage of the fact that our perspective, we have access to all this information and all these opportunities, and we think of them. And unfortunately, in my district, so often, so many young people don't know that these opportunities exist. So starting when kids are really young, I see a lot of these questions here. Starting when kids are very, very young is really, really important if you want a sustainable retraining or sustainable opportunities, even in career technical education, because we did, the first year I was here, we did $900 million for career technical education, which will expire this year. And it is more important now than ever that, those funds are continued and are sustainable for an ongoing, and we face our challenges due to local control funding formula on making that happen. And as a legislature, I'm really proud of my colleagues that they have made this a priority, whether it's workforce and cap and trade or whether it's career technical education. I think there was a time where everyone just focused on four-year universities and we forgot about the 80-so percent of kids that will never see the inside of a community college or a four-year university. Somehow we have just dismissed them altogether. And I am incredibly proud of my colleagues because they're starting to remember about those kids. And it is those kids that will make the difference as technology changes. It is those kids that will really benefit from career technical education. And those are the kids that will help all of your companies succeed. So I think that's first and foremost on career technical education, on changing the workforce. We have to start a little younger and remember that in a disadvantaged community, it is not coding or data analytics are not obvious or even in the minds of our kids, but we can put it there. And it is our responsibility as a legislator. I feel like it is incumbent on me to make sure that those kids know what opportunities exist for them. And when you talk about child poverty, we have 2 million kids in poverty right now. And the path leading out of that, it is not just for their parents to be retrained, but it is incumbent on us that we start to show them what is possible as young people.
Interesting. Yeah, wow, it's amazing. You know, I just read yesterday that Apple has invented a simpler form of coding language and has made a curriculum and is giving it to kids because the idea is that it should be taught along with reading. And it's very interesting. I wonder, and this to the panel here, is there one policy that the federal government or the state government should do right now that would have the greatest effect on moving the ball forward here?
In the short term or the long term?
It's up to you.
We're short term thinkers in general in the legislature, so why don't you start there?
2 year cycles.
I'm gonna pass to the left and think about it.
Do you want to answer that?
Put somebody else on
the spot.
You
should.
Well, I usually get myself into trouble when I try to answer these kind of questions. So, to be consistent with my boss and mentor, Andrea McAllister, I really think we need to push stuff down to the local level. So the local governments need to lead, and then there's a role for the state to play to fill gaps, but there's so much connection to schools and to training and to, you know, building permitting and other areas that are at the local level, and they're so underfunded. If there's a way that we can figure out a way to balance that better, I think we'd be in much better shape. So we have this huge issue where we don't have great data on this, but we have a lot of anecdotal information that says that 80% of our residential HVAC jobs don't get permitted. And that's a combination, therefore they're not, we have no idea if they probably aren't getting installed as we would like them to and as is required by code. And that's in large part because of the inadequate training and certification of those contractors, and also because the local governments don't have the resources to enforce our code requirements. That's such a huge systemic issue that we we really need to figure out a way to solve that problem, because that's at the very lowest end of kind of technology and innovation is just residential jobs, residential energy efficiency and, you know, heating and cooling jobs. We're all using our air conditioners today, and we want them to work as specified, and we really rely on those local contractors to do that. And if there's a way to get funds and resources and training and certification at that level, I think we'd be doing a lot better.
Jim, I want to call your attention to the third one here with the red circle by it. Some parts of the United States, retraining has been dismally unsuccessful. What obstacles do you see, and what are some key solutions to overcome these in California and beyond?
Yeah, so a lot of it has to go with fragmentation, that there isn't a unified solution to retrain our workers. You know, the 300 or some large percentage of the 300,000 energy efficiency workers that are out there today. That's the big issue. The other issue is that a lot of these folks work for contractors. Many of them are small contractors that can't afford to let their workers be released for training. And so that's kind of a big issue. So how do you train folks who their boss, their employer can't afford to release them for training? So there needs to be some online curriculum sharing platform that allows, you know, out of hours kind of training that can be applied on the job or in a more formal setting in a way that is attractive to contractors. Because honestly, what's coming here, and a lot of it's already here, is, you know, advanced energy analytics that are required to operate intelligent buildings. There's energy auditing that more and more of that is being promoted. AB 802 is starting a trend in that direction. There's microgrids, there's storage. You know, these skills don't really exist today. So we need to find a solution, sort of like, and Martha's too modest to talk about this, but the AB 758, Existing Building Energy Efficiency Action Plan, which sets a number of policies about how do we implement energy efficiency measures in existing buildings. So I think we need to take that step farther to talk about residential in a different way, to talk about, you know, the new technologies that are coming out. Perhaps the CPUC should look at incentives for contractors to do training of their employees. These are all things, and I think there's a business case to be made for contractors. They just don't know it yet, right? I mean, doing quality work is actually good business, and being able to implement the latest technologies is good business, but we need to put the business case together for them to understand that so that it's easier for them to justify training their own employees.
Certainly, and you know, going to my biz dev mode here, you know, Daniel, I hear opportunity here, because you mentioned the need for a platform for curriculum sharing. Sounds like a great space for Microsoft.
Well, yeah, we again, to our core, you know, business competence and place, that we sort of power, we're the underpinning technologies, the databases and the server architectures and some of the controls. So we build these lower level layers upon which higher level applications get built. Mm-hmm. So we do partner with and work with the four or five major training initiatives that have been, that basically sprang forth from the likes of Stanford and MIT and Harvard and others, where there's Coursera and there's a series of other ones, I can't remember all the names. Four or five really key ones. Khan Academy is one that, mm-hmm. I was at the Tech Museum and ran the Tech Awards program, and they came through that program. That gave them visibility. That was Saul Khan when he was working out of his bedroom, one of his bedrooms in his house, and the closet was the place where he was doing everything. And then that shined a light on them, and they received all kind of financing from others. And so we're really big on the plumbing and infrastructure. Our domain expertise tends to be that, but I would say we have some programmatic approaches. We have something we call MSAA, which is a Microsoft Software and Systems Academy. We've targeted military bases with that for retraining military service personnel coming back from overseas. We ran some pilots in some cities, working with community colleges with a similar curricula, where we look at our partner ecosystem. In the US alone, there's nearly 500,000 partners of Microsoft who employ people who deploy the solutions that sit on top of our stack. So knowing what their job needs are and then tuning it and building the kind of programs that will, well, again, the content needs to come from the people who know the domains the best. Mm-hmm. So we like to go along on the underlying computational thinking, early education, and so we support the you know, code.org, and we support all the DigiGirls programs and those kinds of programs to feed the lower level, because that's where you go long. It's a little bit like immigration. Just as a final comment, I'll say we have been arguing for high-skilled immigration that targets job creation, because each of the high-skilled employees that either come in or stay as a result of their graduate degrees and they're here, they it ripple effects, and they employ 3 to 5 other people or more underneath them. But the argument is to the federal government, charge us a lot of money for those and put that money into early childhood training so that you get computational thinking in the system, and then motivate the states to actually agree that computer science is a science and not an elective, because most states in this country don't do that. It took a lot of effort, even in California, to get that move through. So we have to have a belief system that we can change the structure on these things, and then we can make it work.
Well, now, Ms. Burke, seeing as how you're a legislator and you write laws, and your laws are comprehensive packages that create economies, create markets, move the levers of our state, and you're in a room full of people who pretty much embody little levers, some not so small either. And I'm wondering how, what would be your prescription to all of us in terms of tasks or action in order to integrate and co-invest to drive success for your initiatives, which benefit us all?
First of all, thank you. That was a high compliment. I usually am not told that we create economies, so that's I'm going to take that and run with it. I might leave now. Listen, we work with so many of you all the time, and I think, to your point, it's important that you're part of the process and be politically minded and be policy minded. We don't create our laws and we don't create our legislation, and whether it's something as large as a cap and trade program or as small as an AB 217, a low income solar initiative, we don't do them to do harm, and we're hoping we're encouraging an economy, and we're hoping we're encouraging an inclusive economy where all communities get an opportunity to participate. However, I think that sometimes we miss the boat, and sometimes we miss the boat sometimes. And I think a lot of times that's because there's not enough interaction between yourselves and us. I think it is very, very easy to get kind of stuck over there in the building and think you have these great ideas. And a lot of times some of our wonderful ideas have consequences that we have not foreseen. And so I have lots of friends in the room who have spent a lot of time in my office over the last couple months. But it's really important, that time, that investment in whoever your legislator is and whoever your senator is, spending that time educating on what's going on, because, like I said, and I'm not trying to insult us, but we are short-minded, and we really don't look very long-term. Unlike so many of you, we don't, and I complain about this constantly, we just got a whiteboard in my office, because I come from a small business world where usually you whiteboard a plan and then you move towards a plan. The way that policy works now, we piecemeal plans and kind of hope they all integrate and work well together. And it is really important when those pieces don't all fall together because they weren't made in a linear fashion, that you come to us and talk to us so that we can make those adjustments. I think it's incredibly important that the folks that are in here are successful and that you bring along disadvantaged communities and all the communities along with you as you are successful. And I really hope that it is my job and my colleagues' job to make sure both of those things happen. But we can't do it without the communication from both all of us.
Excellent. Any thoughts along those lines, Martha?
I think that I think that Andrew McAllister also was very welcoming, and we meet with many of you every week, and we always learn so much. It is really incredibly important. And it's also true that state agencies, for better or for worse, can get siloed and can get their blinders on, and you need to challenge us to keep our eyes wide open. And we do produce an integrated energy policy report almost every year now, but it needs stakeholder involvement to be really thoughtful and aligned with our not only our workforce but our clean energy economy goals. You know, things like demand response. We've been talking about demand response at the Energy Commission for at least a decade, and we still are underperforming in that arena. And it's because we have silos at the Public Utility Commission and at the Energy Commission and at the California ISO, and we're working and trying to integrate our missions and our goals to get more distributed energy resources to act as a power plant, because we know that there's just lots of value and effectiveness in that approach. But I'm just reminded of this because we're in another policy report period now, and we're kind of reviewing our four-year-old recommendations, and we have all the same issues and recommendations today as we did 4 years ago. So we need your help to help us really articulate the challenges and the solutions to moving forward with our clean energy economy.
Thank you. And on that note, so it's important to, the lessons we're gleaning here today is that we're all here together, and our trillion-dollar economy can only grow if we bring more people into it and expand markets. And the rest of the country is looking to us for leadership, and the world, as we heard earlier with the China trip, the Barrier Council. So I encourage you all to participate with these panelists and myself and each other to really create change in California. Thank you.